Hi, I'm Richard Moran, Senior Minister at Unity of Phoenix Spiritual Center, and I want to thank you for visiting our website and for tuning in to today's message. If you feel inspired by today's talk, I really encourage you to make a donation by hitting that button below and making a contribution to this ministry. It'll allow us to continue these messages online and to do the great work we do here at Unity of Phoenix, which is to inspire people to live better lives. So thanks for tuning in, thanks for your support, and we hope to see you at a Sunday real soon.
So this husband and wife, they're both 65 years old and they're quickly approaching their 40th anniversary. Both 65, approaching their 40th anniversary. And as they're cleaning up, they're gonna have a big party. They find this old lamp and they rub it. Now pouts a genie and grants them each one wish. And the wife thinks about it for a while and says, I really want something special for us. And she says, I wish, genie, for an all expense paid cruise all around the world. I want it to be first class. I want us to have all of the excursions, everything we can have to have an amazing around the world cruise. And poof, tickets were in her hand, vouchers, everything she needed. And then the husband looks a little sheepish. He says, so I can have anything I want? And the genie said, yes, what would you like? And he said, well, I want to be with a woman 30 years younger. And poof, he was 95. And so, be careful what you wish for, I think. So, what if you found a magic lamp, rubbed it, and the genie would grant you one wish? What would you ask for? What would you wish for? What if you could have it, would change your life in an amazing and wonderful way? You know, what is it that you would desire most in your life right now that would bring you the greatest level of peace, joy, and happiness? What would you heal? What would you change? What would you let go? What would you want to experience? You know, I think stories of genies granting us wishes is something we all kind of resonate and connect with. It's pretty huge in our culture. There are all kinds of genie jokes. There are all kinds of genie TV shows and movies and books. How many people have either seen the recent Aladdin movie or some version of Aladdin in your life? Okay. You know, originally it was originated in the Middle East in a book of Middle Eastern fairy tales entitled The Book of 1001 Arabian Nights. And it was in the early 18th century that the story of Aladdin and the magic lamp really first started. And I think it's a story that we all like and resonate with. I think it's kind of like a Cinderella type of story. We really like those stories. I think there are three reasons we do. And the first one is I think everybody loves an underdog. We want the underdog, the someone who had tough beginnings, to be able to rise up and to overcome and do great things. There's something that we like about transformational, magical experiences where life just turns around in an amazing way from something not so good to something really good. Second one is, I think secretly, or maybe not so secretly, we all wish we had a genie and three wishes or a fairy godmother to help us out, to give us a break, to make our lives a little bit easier, to feel a little more supported. And then the third one is, I think we like these stories because they give us hope. They make us believe again that things are possible, that our dreams, our goals, that life really can get better, that miracles can happen, breakthroughs can happen. So again, what would you wish for? What would you wish for that would have a positive impact on your life? And I think whatever it is you're wishing for, I think there's something deeper and more profound and more lasting that we can wish for that has an impact on our happiness and our success and our relationships, and we don't always realize it. I think Oprah Winfrey alludes to it in something she noticed in decades of interviewing people, from world leaders to scientists to business people to the wealthiest to the poorest, from doctors to the homeless, everything in between. One thing she said was when she interviewed them, almost every single one of them said some version of this. Was that okay? was that good enough? Did that go all right? You think people will like it? That every one of us at some level doesn't think we're quite good enough. At some level, we doubt our greatness. We doubt our beauty. You know, we doubt our talent. We doubt our looks. We doubt how we sound. You know, if we're smart enough, we doubt who we are, what we have, what we do. You know, it is amazing how much self-doubt and how much we don't think we measure up in at least one area in our lives. I mean, from something as simple as not liking our hair or thinking we're too short or too tall. There are so many areas of our lives we don't think we're enough. And it comes in all forms, because sometimes we think, you know, I really should be earning more money than this. I really should have more success than I have. There are all kinds of ways where we judge ourselves of being not good enough. And I would say the struggle we all share is that there is something in us that we struggle with in terms of thinking it isn't good enough. Something in us that we think isn't acceptable, that we're ashamed of, we're embarrassed about, that we just don't think we're good enough. And so we keep chasing, finding ways to validate and to make ourselves feel that we are enough. How many people in at least some area of your life have you ever felt that you weren't good enough? Anybody? And so the story of Aladdin really is about that. That's the message of Aladdin, is that you're good enough. Just the way you are, just how you are, who you are, that you are enough. And I think the spiritual message is to teach us how to move away from this idea that we're not enough to living from a place of knowing that we are enough. Interesting thing is that three of the four main characters, you know, think at some level they're not enough. And here's, I want to show how they think they're not enough and the ways they respond to not being enough. First, Aladdin. He's an orphan, and he's alone. He has no money, and he just steals, and they refer to him often as a street rat. He thinks he's stuffed in poverty. And one day, he accidentally meets, disguised, the princess, and they really hit it off. He doesn't know she's the princess, but he is absolutely captivated with her and wants to meet her again, wants to see her. He has this feeling that he's just not enough. You know, that he's not successful enough. He's not enough to impress or have anyone like him. And then when he finds out a princess, even more so, he feels like he is just absolutely not enough. He's ashamed of who he is. And here's how he responds to not being enough. He tries to pretend he's something he isn't. That when he gets the genie's lamp, his first official wish is, make me a prince. Because he thinks he's a nobody, and he wants to be somebody. Somebody that will impress, someone that will be respected and liked and appreciated, and royalty and lots of money and status, he thinks, will be the thing. And so he pretends, and he lies, and he, you know, puts on a front so that she will like him. And so what happens in a situation like that, and I love what the genie says to him. He says, the more you gain from pretending, the less you're going to have. Because when we pretend and people like us because we're saying the right things or thing, is that they're liking the image. They're not actually liking us. They're liking the illusion. They're liking the lie. They're liking the pretense. And it makes us feel disconnected from ourselves and even less worthy. And he keeps pushing it, thinking that's the way to go, refusing to actually tell her the truth. So where in your life have you ever pretended or lied or not been honest or upfront about who you are? You know, have you ever had a hard time accepting or not being ashamed of some aspect of yourself? The second thing is Princess Jasmine. You know, I mean, she's the princess. I mean, she's got servants, she's got money, she's got all this stuff. However, her father won't let her leave the palace, that she is not qualified to become the sultan, which she'd like to be one day. And she finds all these things where she is just not listened to or not taken seriously. And so she is told over and over again that she's not good enough. And the way that she responds to her aspect of not feeling good enough is she doesn't speak up. She dims her own light She doesn't own her greatness, and she just stuffs it and stays silent to not rock the boat. And so again, where in your life have you just stayed quiet, not owned your greatness, just settled and dim your light so nobody else would feel comfortable? And then the third one, which might surprise you, is Jafar. He really, at a level, does not feel good enough. If you don't know, he's the sorcerer and kind of the bad guy of the movie. But the thing about it is, you can really tell, you know, someone may act aggressive, but it's because they're not feeling secure or good about themselves. And here's his one line that reveals it, that he tells to Aladdin. He said, if you're not the most powerful man in the room, you are nothing. And he even says to Aladdin, as he was trying to get him to go in the cave to find the lamp, he says, you're nothing, but I could help you change that and make you rich, and maybe the princess will like you. So his whole basis is, if you're not this, you are nothing. And the way he responds is by being aggressive, manipulative, using people and being mean to try and make himself superior, because he really, at some level, does not feel like he is good enough. And I'll tell you, that mindset of believing that if I don't have X, I won't be happy, or if I don't have X, I won't be successful, or if I don't have X, that I will not be enough, is something that I think is prevalent in our culture. I'll be happy when I meet the right one. I'll be happy when I earn X amount of money. And it's because it's some idea, like I'm not good enough right now. Our lives aren't good enough right now. And there's always this deferring. And so look at the ways we respond when we don't feel good enough. It's we pretend, or we just stay silent and don't own our greatness, or we become aggressive and try to act superior or put other people down. What I find really interesting is that Aladdin feels trapped in poverty, and Jasmine feels trapped in the palace. She thinks he's free and adventurous and fun and knows so much and explores, and he thinks she's got it made, power, status, and money. And yet both feel a little bit empty, like they are really not enough. I think there are a lot of messages there about how we judge ourselves and others by externals, how we judge ourselves and others in a lot of different ways. But the most important thing, I think, in life, and the reason I talk about that one wish that I think is to come to a place where we feel and know that we're enough. You know, because how we show up in life when we feel we're not enough is drastically different than how we show up in life when we feel that we are enough. The level of joy and sincerity and spirit, and not always having to prove ourselves. You know, there is something freeing and engaging and joyful when we know that we're enough. Because then we're not afraid to try, we're not afraid to fail, we're not afraid to fall, because we know no matter what, we're okay. So here are the three things we can do to start living from a place of knowing that we're enough. And the first one is to believe in ourselves. You know, the fact is, as the Bible says, you are created in the image and likeness of God. Like, that's as good as it gets. It says you are wondrously and joyously and uniquely made, that you are literally an expression of the divine. You're an expression of God. You know, the same intelligence that made the mountain and the trees and the oceans made you and brought you here for a purpose to do great and wonderful things. You know, there are only eyes like your eyes. Nobody else has them. You know, there's talents and beauties and your smile and your personality and gifts that only you can give to the world. You know, one of the things I love is that it says, to enter this cave where the magic lamp is, it says the only person come in is the diamond in the rough. And the truth is, I think we're all diamonds in the rough. I think we all have beauty and light and greatness in us, but part of life is that journey of owning it, discovering it, accepting it, celebrating it, and sharing it and expressing it. So we're all diamonds in the rough, going through that unfolding spiritual process of owning our greatness and our magnificence. But we got to believe it's there and accept it, that it's there. One of my favorite lines in the book of John is, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never overcome the light. Do you believe that there's a light in you that no darkness could ever overcome? that there is beauty and genius and talent and greatness in you that has been in there from the time, you know, you came forth into this amazing and wonderful experience called life. The fact is only you can go into that inner cave and find that magic lamp and to connect with that spirit and source to create something greater in your life. The question is, do you believe it? Do you believe in yourself? Do you believe that magnificence is in you? I am enough. Let's say that together. I am enough. Take a deep breath. Again. I am enough. Deep breath. How about this? I am and will always be enough. Together. I am and will always be enough. Deep breath. Turn to the person to your left and right and say, you are enough and you are and will always be enough. All right. You feel better or just sillier? Either way, it's a good deal. It's a good deal. Number one about knowing that you're good enough is to believe in yourself. And there is so much to believe in. And the second one is to be yourself. One of the things I love is that Aladdin, when he becomes a prince, he gets presented to the princess and the royal family, and he just says the most ridiculous, horrible things. I mean, it was just, he embarrassed himself. And then after that horrible experience in the evening, there's a party, and they go into the party, and it's clearly, it was off to a rocky start. And the genie says, don't worry, you're not out of the game yet. And he says, well, how? Aladdin says, he said, just try being yourself. And Aladdin keeps arguing over and over, yeah, but I don't have this, and that other prince has got money, and blah, blah, blah. And the genie says to him, I made you a prince on the outside, but I cannot change the inside. Prince Ali got you to the door, but Aladdin has to open it. And so every time he doubts in himself, the genie keeps saying, try being yourself. Try being yourself. And one of the cool things is, so when she goes to this balcony, they go on this carpet ride, and he shares about how he knows so much about the city and what he loves, all the secret hiding places, and shares all this stuff, and her heart just opens up. And that's in the movie when they sing A Whole New World. She literally, he opened a whole new world to her, this poor little kid, guy, because he had perspective and personality, and for the first time he was being himself. She fell in love with him. Not a prince and wealth, but all the creativity and passion and joy and curiosity and adventurous spirit that he had. And it was a gift that blessed her and made an absolute difference. And sometimes we think being ourselves isn't enough, but being ourselves is the magic and the uniqueness that we and the gift that we have for the world. Somebody once said, be yourself. Everyone else is already taken. The best gift you have to offer is the uniqueness of who you are. And what we need is to give ourselves permission to just be who I am, to be how we are. I remember when I first started out in ministry, you know, I would find myself being really goofy and silly and playful, and I always think, come on, man, act more ministerial, more stoic, more manly, more intelligent. But that's not me. And so, sometimes, you know, you gotta get to a point where you just be yourself. That's what we have to offer. Anyone could be a pretend some version of somebody else, and that always limits the joy for us and for the people receiving it. Being yourself will bring you more joy, will bring people more gifts and talents and excitement and feel real authentic connection. But we have to risk just being ourselves. And yes, sometimes some people will leave, but guess what? New ones will come. And it'll be a more authentic, honest relationship and not a pretend one. So somebody came up to me at a class the other day and said, hey, I know the producer of this Aladdin movie, and he's a friend of mine. His name is Dan Lin. And would you like me to, I'm going to email him. You want me to ask him anything? I said, yeah. What's the spiritual message in the movie? And I looked up Dan Lin, and he was born in Taiwan, and he came to the U.S. with his family when he was 5 years old. He went to Wharton Business School, then he went to Harvard and did his MBA, and he did a summer program where he did an internship at Warner Brothers Studios and worked with an executive. And so after he graduated, they offered him an entry-level position. In 7 years, he became senior vice president of production. So he rose to kind of a high level. And then he started his own company. Some of the movies he's worked on include The Departed, The Aviator, Invasion, Matchstick Men, and Scooby-Doo 2, which I thought, I love the range of movies. And of course, he did the Lego movie. He did Sherlock Holmes. And he also did, of course, Aladdin. Here's what he wrote to me through this congregant. The main message we were trying to impart was that you are enough. God made you for who you are, and you are special. Aladdin doesn't think he is good enough, as he is an orphan and a street rat, so he feels that he has to pretend and transform to be a prince to win the girl. At the end, he learns that she loved him for who he was, the pauper, and not the prince. Jasmine also learns that she is good enough, as she is and won't be silenced anymore. She expresses that in her song, Speechless. She is kept down by her father, the Sultan, and Jafar, but it's only when she stands up for herself and her beliefs is that she is fulfilled. And finally, Dahlia, the handmaiden who falls in love with the genie, didn't fall in love with him in genie form. She fell in love with him in human form and truly fell in love with who he really is. And then my favorite line, hey, it's kind of cool that Aladdin is being used in a sermon. Would love to hear it if it's on a podcast. So I thought that was really cool. And so I really believe that the key to a successful and happy life is to be yourself. The final one I want to talk about is about, let's talk about Jafar for a second, is that one of the things about it, his reaction to not being enough was more power, controlling people, you know, using them, manipulating them to have power over them, because it's a sign that you don't feel like you're enough, that you're weak. And he kept getting greedier till the end that he becomes a genie and he gets put into the bottle. And so for me, you know, one of the things about these four characters, Aladdin, Jasmine, Jafar, and the genie, is it's not good guy and bad guy, it's those qualities are all in us. There's the Aladdin in us that doesn't feel like we're good enough, that pretends. There is the Jasmine in us that knows we're good enough, but doesn't always stand up for ourselves. There's Jafar in us that thinks we're nothing and uses aggressive ways. You know, anybody ever get mad and you felt a little weak or hurt and you started being controlling over someone? Okay, if it's not you, do you know someone who might be that way? Okay. And the genie in us is that place in us where we know we can tap in to some place more powerful that makes everything possible. All those characters are in us. And the question is, how are we utilizing those? One of the things I found very interesting was that every single one of the main characters who allowed themselves to be were changed. And the thing, you know what changed them? Love. Love is what changed them. Look at the relationship with the genie and Aladdin. That Aladdin at one point said to the genie in the beginning, what wish would you wish for? And the genie said, in 10,000 years, no one ever asked me that question. And then later in the movie, the genie referred to Aladdin as his friend, when prior he'd said, masters and genies aren't friends. And that's how touched the genie was that Aladdin asked him that question. And then Aladdin said that he would give him the genie his third wish. And then at the end of the movie, which was to be free, he gave him that. So there was a love between them, and really the genie got free because of love, because of the love of a friend. The second thing about love is also the genie and the handmaiden, Dahlia, fell in love. And if you just watch this particular scene, he comes to the door and he wants to impress her, And he says, and she opens the door, and she is crazy about him, but pretending not to be. And so he said, would you like to go for a walk or blah, 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 or and these flowers are for you. She takes the flowers. She says, excuse me a moment. She closes the door, freaks out, and jumps in the air, and then opens the door calmly and said, sure, I believe I could go for a walk with you. And it goes back and forth like that. And just watching people in love and even goofiness on the screen can't help but open your heart. Another love that was really cool to watch was the love of the father for his daughter. The Sultan loved his daughter so much that he broke and changed the bylaws and rules to say that a woman, his daughter, could become the Sultan, and also changed the rule that she didn't have to marry a prince. She could marry who she wanted. And it's that love of the father for the daughter that opened the love, opened the possibility for the future for Jasmine to be the Sultan and to love Aladdin. And finally, the love that Jasmine had for the people and her country and her family and the leadership is what got her to stand up to Jafar and to defeat him and take the rightful claim as a Sultan. And so one of the things I really believe is that love is the thing that heals us, changes us, opens us. Paul said, love is the fulfilling of the law. And I believe that love is what makes life fulfilling. Love heals. Love transforms. Love awakens. You know, love does profound things. And one of the things I believe is whether you're going through a divorce or struggling with addiction or health or financial issues, when you know that you are loved, it makes the ride so much smoother. You feel so much more secure knowing that people love you and that there are people in your life that you love. Emmett Fox says there's nothing in the world that love can't heal. There's nothing in the world that love will not make better. The question is, are we open to allow love to transform us and to heal us in an amazing way? So in my opinion, what does it mean to believe that you're enough? It's to believe that you're loved. It is to believe that you are lovable. See, love is the greatest thing we could wish for. Love is the magic lamp. Love is what lifts us. Love is what makes us know that we're enough. Love is what creates a whole new world. Love and knowing that you are enough is a special message and gift for all of us from the movie Aladdin. God bless you all.